met on Instagram, as one does. It's a very 21st century relationship. Mm. I had become associated with the 2022 Batman film, and Jim Lee posted, I think, the first screen test of the red image of Robin the Batsuit when that first came out, and he either tagged me in it or he mentioned me in it, and that led to people who followed Jim following me. It was a very overwhelming day, and so that I think that's how you became aware that I was on the planet.
That's exactly it, yeah.
And then when I watch a movie on Instagram, I will post three images from the movie in my Instagram stories, and I suppose you liked some of the shots that I was posting.
Yeah, I think I was following him for like maybe 2, maybe 3 months, and he just kept posting great shots, and not, you know, the still frames they release for movies. Like, he was choosing moments, like not the typical moment someone would, you know, like, he posted some I Saw the Devil stuff. And that was when I think I responded, right?
I responded to
that stuff.
So we decided to get online together, and we had a Skype session, but to just say hello, because I was a huge fan of Lee's work. And in that first Skype session, it very quickly turned into a conversation of Lee asked me, have you ever thought about doing a comic book? And I said, yes, of course. And we started very quickly talking about ideas, and the idea for Vicious Circle was discussed pretty early on, probably in that first session. And so then within a week, I sent an outline of a version of what I thought that it could be. And off of that, we kind of linked arms and said, okay, like, let's go do this. So it's very simple.
Yeah, and in important context, so this is February 2020. So a pandemic is just like kicking in. So I had just gone into lockdown in Italy. I don't think you guys were in lockdown yet, but it was getting gnarly, I think, everywhere. And I was just completely, I'm not gonna say adrift, but I had finished Batman Damned, and I knew I wanted to kind of just do something new. I knew I wanted I needed a challenge. I needed to find something new. And I think it was a combination of like us hanging out and it just kind of being natural and fun. And also just having seen the eye that he had, I just had this kind of sense where I was like, this could be something. And I knew that if he was part of the Batman, that had a feeling I already knew I was gonna enjoy, because everything they had been talking about up to that point and what little you'd seen was right up my alley. So I thought maybe there's gonna be a real artistic kind of kinship in that way that we can really kind of jam, you know, just jam. And that's exactly how it happened. So supernatural, easy, and ooh, where does the desire to be an illustrator come from? Probably because I don't think I could do anything else well. And I think as a child, drawing became, for me, such an important thing in my life. I didn't even realize at the time how kind of connected it was with who I am. You know, a lot of kids draw, almost every kid, you know, you give them pen and paper and they'll start drawing. But for me, it was always something else, where I think even my parents were very aware that I remember when I was at 12 or 13, my father was actually worried because I was spending so much time drawing that to him it was unhealthy. He thought it was not, I should be outside, I should be active and doing other things, and here I was in my room drawing. And so there was a point in time where he actually was actively trying to keep me from drawing, because he felt like I was so obsessively into it that it could turn into like a, I don't know, but it's just always been so connected to my life that I don't know I can ever not do it. When I was a kid, my parents were still in university, and as kind of a babysitting mechanism, my parents would rent a VHS machine, and there was a very small selection of VHS movies in this tiny town in Ohio that I, you know, was living in at the time. And one of those was the Batman 69 movie, the Adam West movie. And so they would rent that over and over and again for me to watch. And I just was obsessed with it. I was obsessed with the utility belt and this idea that, like, you know, I didn't understand the humor in it at the time. I was just super interested in figuring out, okay, so he slides down the bat poles and is suddenly in his costume. How does that happen? You know, like, what, is there a room in between where he stops and like, I was trying to make sense of this very silly, you know, comic booky thing. And, that led to me buying comic books and getting into the comic books. And then the Tim Burton Batman movie came out I think I was 11 or 12 when that movie came out. So it was perfect timing for me to become obsessed with that movie. And it's just the pop culture character that appealed to me the most. So did I research the different timeline? Yeah, you have to, you know, and part of that was in the script. Most of it was in the script because Mattson would often include little links in the document to photographs or, you know, paintings and stuff like that. So yeah, the research was done, I think, very much in tandem because he was obviously having to be the first pass at what those time jumps were going to be, you know?
The research for the time jumps in A Vicious Circle, for me, it always starts with it being about contrast and about, you never want to go from the character in 1965 to 1967 because there's no contrast there. It'll feel like the same thing. You want them to go from 1965 to 2067 or 1767, because then there will be a very sharp difference that the audience can see very easily. And so for me, when I'm writing, it's always figuring out, okay, what's the contrasting moment? And to also contrast in terms of the space, you know, if they're inside, going to the outside, if they're in the rain, going to the desert. So always just making sure that one space to the next is very, very clear so that the audience doesn't get confused. And then once I know that, then it's a matter of just going, okay, where were we? We were in a room with a baby in a crib, and there's a guy in overalls, and it kind of seems like the South in the 30s or 40s. Let's go to a Russian bathhouse. Those two things seem very different. And then for me, it's just a matter of going, giving Lee a couple of references and saying, oh, you know, there's like a little Eastern Promises moment here where like we're here in a Russian bathhouse with you know, it's like the Vigo scene, and then just kind of seeing what he does with that. So it for me, it's about teeing him up with either a literal image from a photograph or a piece of history, and then a vibe, and then just seeing what he does.
We really talked about everything. It was just a collaboration in the sense where, just creating these characters became about these discussions where, Thacker look like very anonymous, and, you know, should he have the glasses like in Michael Douglas in Falling Down? You know what I mean? Like, there was different things that I remember we talked about together. Even the yellow kind of parka that he winds up wearing was a decision that we talked about and made together, where you're just trying to find a way to really have every element of these characters inform who they are, and of course they have to be visually something that allows for a kind of yin and yang situation between Ferris and Thacker. So yeah, it's everything just born out of the collaboration, you know, the back and forth. it's a different, it's two different things. And I have a hard time saying that one is better than the other. They're both awesome. Like doing Batman is amazing. It's fun to do Batman, you know? And there's something very rewarding about doing Batman too. And there's something else that's rewarding about doing creator-owned stuff. And then this is only my second time doing it. But the nature of this project is so different than anything I've ever done before. I mean, it is literally the most challenging project I've ever done. And so that in and of itself makes this project kind of the most unique thing in my, what do you want to call it? I was going to say comiXology, but you really can't use that term. It's by far though, the most, it's the most epic. It's got the most, scope in terms of what I had to draw and it's the most emotional out of anything I've done. It's got kind of, the perfect storm of here's a guy who's done a lot of Gargoyles and Gotham City, and then this is something where I'm drawing dinosaurs and World War II. So I mean, there's just no way to compare it with anything I've done before. We'll do something else. I'm assuming that.
Yeah.
We will.
We're doing it.
Yeah.
We kind of know what it is.
Yeah. I mean. So it's just nice. You know, like when you see something that's working and it's working well, it's just, of course, you're going to want to do more of that. Yeah.
The thing that inspired me to write comic books is that they are my first love. They came before cinema. I learned how to read off of comic books, and I think I start the way that most kids start, of Batman, Spider-Man. It's like that. But when I was 14 years old, there was a run of Daredevil by Brian Michael Bendis and Alex Maleev, and that run for me really changed the paradigm of how I saw comic books, because it was so emotionally adult. It was akin to growing up and you're watching TV and you're watching Sunday nights, you're watching Malcolm in the Middle, or I guess in France it's Malcolm, then suddenly you discover HBO and you realize this is what television can be. And that's what Daredevil, that run of Daredevil did for me, because it was so emotionally real. You still had Bullseye and Elektra and jumping off of buildings and Stiltman and all, you had all the stuff that the comics have, but also it just seemed so much more emotionally rich and emotionally adult in a way that I had not been exposed to in comics before. And that really made me always want to go, I want to do this as well. And so through my screenwriting career, through my movie career, there's always been a kind of constant me knocking on the door and going, I'd like to do a comic book. And the door just would not open. It would kind of crack open, but I could never quite crack my way into that industry for a long time, for 5-7 years. And then two things really happened at once. I started doing my uncredited work on the first Batman film. That really opened the door to a relationship with DC Comics. And when I finished my time working on that first film, I got a meeting at DC and pitched Batman the Impostor. And that was born totally out of the fact that I came into the first movie so late into the process. I had so many ideas for Batman that just couldn't apply to that first film, because so much of it had already been written. And so I felt like I was carrying around all these Batman ideas and just had nowhere to put them. And so I thought I'd like to put them into a book. And DC was really gracious enough to give me that opportunity and pair me with Andrea Sorrentino. And so we did Batman the Impostor. And again, as we already said, how Lee and I met was through Jim Lee posting that Batman image and tagging me in it. So basically at the exact same moment that Batman the Imposter was starting to be a conversation, I'd pitched Batman the Imposter at DC 2 weeks before I met Lee. And so I said that the door to the comics industry hadn't really opened. Suddenly it just blew wide open. And I had these two, it's because Batman the Imposter has been out for a moment and A Vicious Circle is still coming out, but they actually were birthed at the same time for me. They're very parallel projects. So for me, it's just a dream come true that's kind of a lifelong dream, and I hope to stay. The starting point for the creation of the story was just the conversation with Lee, and we had been talking about, we kind of came to each other because I had posted stills of I Saw the Devil, and so we were talking about I Saw the Devil and talking about what a brutal revenge story that was, and how it really felt like the kind of movie that has teeth and feels kind of dangerous, and the kind of thing that makes you go, oh, this is intense. I don't know if I can watch, but also I can't look away. So just that feeling was something that we were both charged up about and kind of wanting to recapture. And then just that concept of you kill somebody and then you time travel. I'm gonna do it again, but we disagree about who had that idea. I think it was him. He thinks that it was me.
I really think it was you.
But once we had that, that also just felt like something I haven't seen that before. And so, time travel by involuntary time travel by way of murder. That's not getting into a DeLorean. It's not getting into a time machine. It's not. Falling asleep and waking up in another body. It's not any of those things that we've seen some version of a number of times. And so it's very rare when you come across an idea that feels like, oh, haven't quite seen it like that before. So like that just feels exciting because you feel like you're on kind of new ground. Any piece of work is built on the shoulders of Titans. So of course, there's the influence of Terminator, there's the influence of Looper, there's the influence of Groundhog Day, Edge of Tomorrow, all of those things, because those are kind of the recent great things. But I think also, I Saw the Devil is an important one. And then also just kind of knowing, okay, we're gonna do this kind of epic, sweeping sci-fi story, but also I always go back to Brian Michael Bendis and Alex Maleev and just how emotional that book was for me. And so always making sure that it stays rooted in a place of real, profound human emotion. So no matter how crazy and sci-fi it gets, you're still on the ride with a character and not on the ride just with an idea. For me, a story in the most basic sense, a story, whether or not it's a comic book, whether or not it's a movie, whether or not it's a song, beginning, middle, end. It's like at its most basic, that's what you need. You need beginning, middle, end, character, and a conflict. And so in that sense, it's all the same and doesn't matter. I think that the big difference for me is that in comic books, you have to describe action, and it has to be action in a singular image. So when I'm writing a screenplay, I can say, Bruce Wayne goes into the lobby of Wayne Manor and picks up a teacup. And in a comic book, going into a lobby and picking up a teacup, those are two different things. And so is that going to be two different images? It's going to be one different image. And so just kind of figuring out how do you break down, in a movie, you can describe punching somebody in the face over and over and over and over and over. And in a comic book, you have to make a decision of, are you seeing one punch in one panel? Are you seeing 12 panels of punching over? And so there's a kind of, there's editorial choices that you're making with your collaborator, with the artist of, how do you pace this out? And so there's a different kind of rhythm where in screenwriting, you're just writing. And in comic book writing, you're kind of writing and you're also kind of the editor and you're kind of the co-director. And then meanwhile, the artist is your co-director and the cinematographer and the actor. And so that's kind of how I think about it. It's a little bit different. Do you think that's right?
I agree. Yeah. I agree. Because the editing is a big part of writing, because you don't have that process afterwards of being able to play with the cut, you know? So the writer of a comic has to really have the rhythm and pacing of that story is 100% on the writer's shoulders, I feel, because, you know, it's unchangeable after that, unless you change it.
I am just starting on another DC project that hasn't been announced yet, but I think 2025 is when it's going to come out, so it's not going to be too long of a wait. Lee and I, we're kind of starting to cook on what our next thing is going to be. You know, for me, Lee is like the greatest collaborator that I have, and so I hope to have a long, long career of working with him. And then, writing a novel, I'd love to. I don't know when I'm going to have the time to do that. So maybe when I retire. It's always kind of one of those things of right time and right opportunity. You know, the projects that I'm writing right now, they're big. They're big projects, and they're projects that are, they have audiences that care a lot about them, and they have creators that care a tremendous amount about them. And so, for the time being, I've just been laser focused on, you know, people want to see Batman in theaters again, and so I can't say that I am off making other movies while we're here. But no, the hope is to go and direct another movie sometime in the next 2-3 years.